Hi, everybody. This is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? I hope so. So here we go again. It's another edition of Ask Mr. Duncan with some more of your questions and comments about the English language and my work here on YouTube. Before we begin, here is a question from me. Did you enjoy Dunktober? Was it okay for you? Did you see all of the days? Just in case you are not aware of what happened last month, I celebrated my 7th year on YouTube by hosting a whole month's worth of English video lessons. Yes, a whole month. The month of October became 31 days of Dunktober. There was a new video lesson made for each day. Just in case you missed it, here is the link for the whole playlist. Yes, you can relive the whole of Dunktober again and again, as often as you want, for as many times as you like. Will you be joining me for my 8th anniversary next year? I hope so. So now we have that done and dusted, let's have our first question for today. What does the phrase in lieu mean? This question was sent in by Donna, who lives in Italy. On its own, the word lieu means place. It is a French word for premises or place. We often use this word in the phrase in lieu. This sentence means instead of or in place of what is usually there. The usual thing is not being used, so something else is there in its place. The new thing is being used in lieu of what is normally there. When you start a new job, sometimes you are expected to work a week in lieu. This means that you will not be paid for the first week's work. We can also call this working a week in hand. The phrase in lieu is still used often, especially when it comes to discussing work contracts and payment agreements for contracted work to be done. Thank you, Donna, for your question, and a big hello to everyone watching in Italy. Did you really make a new Dunktober video every day? A large number of people have posed this question to me. Well, the answer is yes and no. Yes, I did make a new Dunktober video every day, but not on the actual day. Most of the lessons were recorded the day before, although this was not the original intention. After doing some test shots for the month, I realised that it would take too long to film, edit and upload each day's lesson. The uploading itself took around 7 hours for each video. The longer ones took over 11 hours to transfer to YouTube. So, I had no choice but to film and edit each video the day before, then upload it overnight, so it would be available the next morning. Another factor I had to consider was, of course, the time difference. Some countries are ahead of the UK's time, so an overnight upload was the only solution to the problem. In total, each video lesson took around 6 hours to make and another 7 hours to upload. So each Dunktober video took around 13 hours to make, from filming the scenes to being available to view. It was all hard work, and I had a couple of very late nights when things went wrong, but it was well worth the effort. If you want to take a look at all 31 days of Dunktober, here is the playlist. Are you easily offended?
Hello, is that the BBC? I wish to register a complaint. I am very, very offended. Very offended, indeed.
Are you easily offended by things that are said or done? If you see or hear something that offends you, what do you do? Recently here in the UK, there have been quite a few instances of people becoming angry and offended by all sorts of things. A person might object to a joke or a comment made by someone. A politician might say something without thinking. A song might cause offence through its lyrics. If a person is offended by something, then they might complain to someone. If a group of people are offended, then they might protest. If a celebrity or a company causes offence, then people might avoid going to see their movies or refuse to buy their music, or they boycott the company. The word boycott means to avoid something, often in protest. You boycott the supermarket. You shun them. You refuse to go there in protest. When people are offended, then an apology is normally demanded. The person or people responsible for causing the offence must say sorry. Should people have the right to say anything they want? Can censorship ever be justified? How much freedom should freedom of speech give? How do we use the passive voice in English? This question was posted on my Facebook page by Norlan, who lives in Nicaragua. Besides English, the passive voice can exist in other languages too, but in English, the uses are far more varied. First, it would be a good idea to mention the active voice. An active voice is one that puts the noun at the beginning of a sentence. The focus is on the named thing. The dog bit the man. With the passive voice, the emphasis falls on the subject. The man was bitten by the dog. The important part of the sentence becomes the outcome of the event. When using the passive voice, the effect becomes the focus of the sentence. We can also use the passive voice to show that certain details are not important, or that they are not to be disclosed or revealed, or they are still unknown. The only important thing is what the outcome was. Sometimes who or what was involved is not revealed. A new cure for cancer has been discovered. You can see that in this sentence, the outcome is more important than the action. The passive voice allows you to get the most important information out first. It is worth mentioning that not everyone likes the passive voice. In fact, there are some who find its use quite wrong. In storytelling, it may sometimes be better to use the active voice, as the action would seem to be more important than the outcome. The fight would be over before it even started. In certain sentences, the passive voice allows you to get to the point much quicker. What did he do becomes, he did what? An idiom and a proverb coming your way. You know I love idioms and proverbs. They always tickle my fancy. I always enjoy using them. Today's idiom is fight tooth and nail. This idiom means that you will do whatever it takes to achieve or get something. You will put all of your energy and effort into having something, whatever it takes. You will stop at nothing to obtain the thing you desire. You can also say fight tooth and claw, just like a wild animal. A favourite proverb of mine is, a fool and their money are soon parted. This is often said to someone who has just made a wasteful purchase. They bought something that is useless or has no real value. We are saying that perhaps a little more thought should have taken place before deciding to buy the item. A person who fritters, squanders, and wastes their money too easily may be seen as being foolish. A fool and their money are soon parted. What are the most commonly used contractions in English? This is a question I have recently been asked by Rina in Morocco and Alsim in Egypt. A contraction in English is the shortening of part of a sentence. We often use contractions when saying do not and did not. These become don't and didn't. Will not becomes won't. Shall not becomes shan't. Does not becomes doesn't. You are can be shortened to your. Should not becomes shouldn't. A very common contraction is it's. This is a shortened version of it is. When stating gender, we can use contractions. He is becomes he's. She is becomes she's. Other common contractions include I would or I had, which become I'd, and I will, which becomes I'll. Contractions in English are used a lot. They have become an informal way of both writing and speaking, and have become normal and commonplace now. Do I really have a loose tooth, or is it just my finger moving in and out? Your kind comments and lovely emails. If you watched during my Dunktober month, then you will know that during the final week, I featured some of your email and Facebook comments. From now on, I will be doing the same thing in each edition of Ask Mr. Duncan. If you are going to send a comment to me, either through Facebook or email, please don't forget to include your name and where you are watching. So now it is time to take a look at some of your comments. Another milestone reached. So, I have now been making these video lessons for over 7 years. To be honest, that time has really flown by. I can't help thinking back to those early days while I was still working in China, those early attempts at making videos and posting them to a relatively new website called YouTube. The basic technology that existed back in 2006 is nothing compared to the equipment that is available now. Super clear stereo sound and high definition video is the norm now. Who'd have thought that 7 years later we would be watching such high quality video streaming through the internet? The way in which all this has occurred in such a short time is mind-blowing. And the most exciting thing of all is that it is by no means over. I have no intention of stopping my work here on YouTube. If anything, what I'm doing now can only expand and grow. Of course, this can only happen if you are there watching. Will you be there? I hope so. So here's to another 7 years of fun and excitement in the wonderful world of English. Which English textbooks do you recommend? This question is one I get asked many times. First of all, it would be unfair of me to recommend just one or two English textbooks, because there are so many out there for sale. The most useful textbooks are the ones aimed at your particular level of English. Most good textbooks will have the reading level clearly marked on them. If you are teaching beginners, then there really is no harm in using books aimed at very young children. I would even recommend this to adults learning English. From my own experience, I have found that sometimes learning like a child is the best way to pick something complex up. The simpler something is explained, then the faster it can be grasped. If only they did a physics textbook aimed at five-year-olds, then maybe I could finally grasp that baffling subject once and for all. One thing I would recommend to anyone learning English is a good dictionary. I tend to use dictionaries published by Oxford University Press. They also do a range of lightweight reference books to go with their much heavier publications. When it comes to teaching or learning English, there is no substitute for a good old-fashioned paper dictionary by your side. Almost time to say goodbye. That is all from me for today's Ask Mr. Duncan. Don't forget to check back soon for oodles of new stuff, loads of new video lessons, tons of new words, and of course, me. 2013 has been an incredible year, and I'm really looking forward to being here with you during 2014 and beyond. Let me remind those who haven't yet seen it to check out the Dunktober playlist containing a whole 31 days worth of English video lessons just for you. This is Mr. Duncan in a cool and chilly England saying thank you for watching me answering you. And of course, ta-ta for now. Mm.